What's up, everyone? It is Physio Friday. Today we have our resident physiotherapist Phil White here with us. We're going to be answering your physio questions, but we're also going to be talking about ramp loading. What does peak week mean? What does deload week mean? And we're going to be revealing our flash sale. Hey everyone, in case you haven't met, my name's Rad Burmeister. I'm joined today by my brother Yani Burmeister. We're the co-founders of Unity Gym and the UMS, Unify Movement System, where we turn driven people into superhumans. And of course, today we have our resident physiotherapist, Phil White, here with us. And
founder of Switched On Physio.
And
All Things Nice and Sugar and Spice.
Probably the most attractive man in the room for those of you
especially
on
my,
the podcast.
My last minute hair drying attempt after cycling into the gym today. So if I've got a bit of a Donald Trump style thing going on there, apologies. Also my own hair cutting
And just for those of you who are not listening on the podcast and who are catching the live Unity V stream, Phil isn't actually tiny. He's not a tiny human.
The camera
has a bit of a fisheye effect.
That looks hilarious.
I was just in the corner.
I just looked at it. Oh man, yeah, Phil.
Hey Phil.
I'm
hello.
Being in a gym with you guys. Pretty massive, but he's not that small.
Yeah. I'm getting
pretty
up.
Sure I'm the tallest
But hey, on that note, for all of you listening on the podcast and watching live, and who's going to be watching the replay on our YouTube channel, this I can confidently say is the last time we're going to be sitting around a coffee table with these shotgun mics and that sort of thing, because all of the parts are almost finished out in the gym, and we're going to be putting it all together over the weekend. And I just announced, it's going to be pretty amazing.
And for those of you listening to the podcast, you can't actually see that I'm drinking a cocochino. I ordered a decaf.
Listen to the coffee that he ordered. He actually asked
decaf macadamia latte, and I got back and these punks have drawn a cock on the top of my coffee. I don't know if you can see that there. Cappuccino on the side. So good times.
Yeah.
You can't see it.
It was a beautiful piece of art.
It's beautiful. Absolutely. And it tastes delicious.
Yes. we've gone there already.
Today, before we get into this, it is Friday. And as you all know, every Friday we release a flash sale, one of our amazing programs at a hugely discounted price.
Exclusively
to the UMS Movement Mastermind, to our tribe, to those of you that listen to the podcast or that watch this stuff. So if you are ready to jump in and try one of our programs, this weekend we have the Press to Handstand Masterclass bundle, which means you get the Press to Handstand Masterclass program and a couple of other programs. You'll have to look in there to see what it is. It's about 90% discount. It is a huge discount. And we've been talking this week, all week, about what it takes to learn a skill. This is an amazing skill that so many people want to be able to do in this group. And I can tell you right now that this program is a guaranteed path to get there. Yani and I followed this path. We learned how to do it, and it's going to get you there, guys.
I can tell you right now, if you're trying to do a pressed handstand without figuring out the pathway to do it, it doesn't work. If anyone remembers the end of last year where Rad was walking me through how to do gymnastics move, the pressed handstand was a personal favorite for me, looking like an absolute idiot because it was just so hard. So, you need to be figuring out each step because it's like your body just... it's impossible.
Now, quickly, before we go further, for those of you on the podcast, this is not very relevant to you, but we do have people watching. We stream these live. We record these live. And we do have 18 people watching live at the moment. So please, if you're watching live, I would love you to chime in with a comment. Let us know where you're watching from, who you are, so we can see who we've got on the live stream. And get any questions in that you've got in relation to injury management, pain management, performance, how to progress or regress movement based on issues that you may be trying to solve in your own body, because we do have Phil here answering those questions to help us answer those questions. And I can see that a few people have commented already, which is fantastic. We're going to get to those comments shortly. And what we also want to do is talk about A drum that we beat regularly, which is our pain management drum. Our load management drum.
The other drum. Yep.
It's the other drum. Yep, yep. And how that sort of ties in, how it all comes together, how the picture comes together with deload week, with peak week, and all that sort of thing, and really why we do it. So why don't we first, very quickly, before we go further, give a brief explanation of load management and why it's important, and hear it from the man himself.
It's so nice to be asked a question in person. If for those who have seen me kind of chiming in at 3 p.m. Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, try to figure my way out how to monologue, it's just so nice to have a person ask me a thing that I can interact with, and it's, yeah. So thanks for those guys have been so supportive at my 3 p.m. attempts, and I'm promising to, yeah, they're getting better. So with load management, why it's so important. Well, basically, like, I could pretty confidently say, like, half the people who, at least half the people who come in to see me for physio appointments, they come in there because they've just tried to get into something too quickly, or they've pushed themselves too hard, and usually they know it too. Like, usually, you know, as you start to go through their history, they're like, oh yeah, you know, so I was kind of in a bit of a funk and then got motivated and then decided to just like dive right into just doing pull-ups every day. It's just human nature to kind of get that sort of surge of motivation to really get into a thing and then just do it as much as you can, because you start to feel that momentum, you start to feel that like that passion, and you do get often like quite a big improvement early. But what happens is, as we've talked about so much before, with tissue adaptation times, like, they play by their own rules, and no amount of, you know, your motivation and forcing it can really, bypass that. So if you start to really overload your structures, I know it's such a
bummer. Frustrating, yeah, especially for people like Rad and I, who are like literally, we make up a very high representation of the idiots who just like to go all in and push ourselves until
it's
we
It's one of those things, even if you know it, like, you still do it. And I've found it really challenging, because I'm, as you know, anyone who follows me knows, I try out lots of new sports and I get really into them and I pay the consequences. And it's a hard thing with human nature to get your head around that, but what you can do is try and prepare your structures for it. And I think the UMS does a really wonderful job of doing that, because it's giving you that variability of exposure to different different contraction types, different styles of loading. So what I mean by contraction types, you get often it's if you start trying to sprint, your muscles haven't been used to like lengthening under tension. And so I really like that the UMS, you know, gives you like a mixture of concentric training, eccentric training. So if you went out and tried something new, then you're a bit more resilient to it. Same thing with energy systems. So if we're with the way that the Unity program changes over the months, you go from phases of, you know, low rep range where you're, you know, really trying to be like looking at strength and power. And there's also phases that go into more endurance where you're using, you know, you kind of go past that stage of just strength and power into more muscular endurance. So you're getting that variability, which is making you more resilient. And then the last thing is with the combination of strength training and the cardio circuits at the end, that's also using, yeah, developing your, you know, there's anaerobic systems and aerobic systems in terms of what powers your body. So your sugar systems is generally your power sprint stuff, and then your fat and oxidization system is your cardio endurance. So it's all these systems need to be exposed to stimulus to be ready for, you know, stimulus. And I think that what people often do is, yeah, go from and each of these kind of systems have thresholds that you can handle before you start to injure yourself. And yeah, I think the Unity system is really good at developing all of those at once, but it does take a gradual exposure, and that's why the programming is such that it is that we have deload weeks and peak weeks.
Something that I think, I don't think we could repeat enough, which I'd love you to just quickly remind our viewers and our listeners on the Sound of Movement podcast, is the different times that it takes to condition and prepare and adapt different tissues to exercise.
Yeah, so we've talked about how often you get a really satisfying strength gain when you first start doing strength training, and so much of that is just your neurological system. So it's your brain figuring out how to access what you already have. Because if you haven't needed to use your muscles in a strength sort of way before, your brain kind of gets used to that and has like a bit of a limiter on how much strength you'll access in your day-to-day. And it's those fight or flight situations where you can do extraordinary things and mothers pick up cars off babies, that kind of stuff, where we have the capability to do it, but we just don't access that system, and we don't train our neurological system to to access that strength. So when you first start training, you might think like, oh, my muscles are getting bigger and stronger really quickly in that first 6 weeks, but really it's just your neurological system catching up. And then after that 6 weeks, your muscles start to actually get larger muscle fibers and you get hypertrophy. So that's for muscles. It generally starts to take about 6 weeks before you start to really see muscle size increase, but you get a big strength increase from just the neurological system. And then from there, for your ligaments and your tendons, which we can kind of put together, ligaments, bone to bone, tendons, muscle to bone, they don't have contractile fibers, they've just got the, they're kind of like, non-contractile. Collagen is the structure that keeps it all together, really strong, good at taking tensile load, but if you can still definitely overload them, and you've got to gradually expose them to load to strengthen them up. So that generally takes more like 3 months to really start to see changes, and there's a much slower tick over then with muscles. So if you just really blast your strength training and your muscles are getting bigger and stronger and you're accessing larger motor units, you're generating more force, you've got to respect the tendons, which are actually attaching it to the bone, because they won't be able to keep up if you really just try and ramp up too quickly.
So. Yeah, of course.
Just quickly, before you dive in, one thing I'd like to get your opinion on. Rad and I supplement collagen. We have collagen protein as our primary protein supplement. And I know that you can, I actually also take a tablet that has collagen added to it. Is that, to your knowledge, I know you're not a nutritionist or a dietitian, is that something that people could do to help benefit the
it's something that I'm
tendons and ligaments?
I'm not kind of aware of it enough to say confidently, and I think it'd be so good to get a dietitian
I'm
or a nutrition
on it.
I think it'd be really good.
Aaron, our friend Aaron, who isn't a nutritionist, but he's someone that has a hell of a lot of skin in the game, and he does a lot of research on this stuff. And even Ben Pakulski, that's why they're both massive advocates of collagen, because from their research, it does help to strengthen.
Yeah, and I think you need the building blocks to actually, build the thing. So if you can have collagen available, and the way that the human diet's changed over the years from going from, eating, nose to tail, where you're getting a wide variety of parts of the animal, where you're getting cartilage and you're getting those kind of organ meats where you get more collagen as part of that, whereas now we just eat like chicken breast and bloody
why so Aaron personally doesn't have collagen protein, but he eats nose to tail so, and he has bone broth all the time, all he's getting it naturally, whereas we're not doing that.
But the thing that I just say is that like it's often really tempting to be like, oh, I'll just like supplement my way out of this problem.
And that's the thing.
You can't. Yeah. Like, you've just got to get your training structure right.
Even the late Charles Poliquin, when I sat in a classroom and heard him speak of supplements, he used to say absolutely that nutrition comes first, supplements come second. Mm. So, if you get everything right with nutrition, then you can take it to the next 5% by starting to supplement or a little bit more, but he used to say,
I'd even argue like with this kind of issue with people getting overload training issues, you can't even nutrition your way out of it. Like it's going to give you a percentage increase of resiliency, but the lion's share of what it's going to safeguard you from injury is how you approach your training and how you structure your rest into that.
I think the reason why that people say that is because, like you just said, it's very easy to go the path of supplementation before diet. And I think it's really important that we reinforce that, diet is paramount first, before you even think about supplementing.
But if we talk a little bit about overload, because that is what we've worked to produce for these last 3 weeks. So the whole idea of the UMS program, where we do these mesocycles and we have a deload week, for those of you that don't understand, there's two states of training to consider what we're talking about here, which is one is overreaching and one is overtraining. Overtraining is almost impossible to do for the average person. It's usually reserved for athletes who are working way harder than even we are here. And when you do go into a state of overtraining, you cause serious damage. A lot of people have to be hospitalized for it, and it can have catastrophic effects to your body for months and months and months afterwards. It's not something that you come out of very easily.
The CrossFit has really brought rhabdomyolysis into the mainstream. It was
things like that. So whereas overreaching is a very different state, and it is something that we actually strive for every mesocycle, because overreaching is just when you get to the point where your everything in your body starts to become fatigued. And I'm doing the parenthesis little things here with my fingers for those of you in the podcast, and in a state of what people might refer to as overtraining, but it's not really. And what the idea is that we gradually increase the intensity to we get to a point of overreaching in week three, where you might even actually feel like you're a little bit weaker. Everything becomes harder, and then you do a deload week where you intentionally reduce the volume dramatically. What we do at the in the UMS is we reduce the volume by 60%, so you go down to about 40% of the normal volume for a whole week. So you're still aiming for strength gains, but you're dramatically reducing the volume. And in that week, you go through something called supercompensation, where your strength goes, your body reacts to the stimulus and strengthens itself to be stronger than it was before. And if you get it right, you come out of deload week stronger than you went into it. And this, everything that we just spoke about nutrition, is absolutely critical to get right in that deload week, because if you get all of the training right, all you've actually done is sent hormonal signals through the body to say, hey, let's go through a phase of adaptation. And the body says, yes, let's do that. Now give me what I need to create that adaptation.
Looks in the bank and sees that the vaults are empty.
The vaults are empty. And what are you going to give me? And I like the analogy of the foreman that turns up to the building site and all the workers are there and says, build this building, but there's no bricks and mortar. Yeah. And all the workers go, yes, let's build the building, but there's nothing there to build it with. And if you get the nutrition right, then that's putting the bricks and the mortar down to the work site.
Yeah, I think there's obviously the training stimulus needs to be there, the nutrition needs to be there for the building blocks. And the other thing that people often kind of like, especially people who train really hard and have generally that kind of personality that's really into push them really hard, they often miss one of the biggest parts of the strength game, which is recovery. And so key, and that's why I think it's so good that you guys have that deload week where you're taking back that stimulus, because when you're increasing with your strength, you want it to just keep going up and up and up. But what it really looks like is this. We've got to be, and that's why we've got those targeted overreach, so you can give yourself enough stimulus to strengthen up, but you've then also got to follow it with that recovery. And there's a really interesting study I've talked about it a few times on the show, I know, but with runners and looking at professional runners versus elite runners versus amateur runners, and basically the professional runners and the elite runners do the same amount of training time, but the professionals are able to hit higher peak intensities because for the rest of the day they can be loafing around, eating, sleeping, chilling out by the beach, whereas the elite who have to go to work, look after the kids, don't get enough sleep, they're waking up really early to train, they're doing the same amount of training time. Like the professionals aren't doing that much wildly more training time. It's just that
but
can't
get those.
Is so key. Yep. And so that's why I think it is so nice to that as part of this program you guys have that that overreach where you're getting that good high intensity, but then you bring it back and
And it's so important to follow that. We've got a couple of really good questions that have come in, guys, that are very much on topic. First of all, I'd like to answer Carmine Mitroni. He said, should I master the loaded stretching routine, all three components, which I still admittedly need a lot of work on, before I begin the mobility masterclass, or can I do them simultaneously without compromise or risking injury? Now, the reason why I jumped into this question first is because a lot of people don't realize that stretching and the mobility masterclass and the loaded stretching routine, it is stimulus. Stretching is stimulus to the muscle and it's load, and it must fall into this umbrella of we need to manage load. And so, Phil and Rad will chime in here and give their opinion. But the first thing I'll say is, when we're learning to manage load accordingly, it's very much up to the individual. There's not a one-size-fits-all answer because there's a lot of variables there, and the main one is how long you've been training for under these conditions. So how physically prepared is your body already for the types of stimulus that we're dealing with?
Your training age is a term that we've used quite a bit before.
Exactly right. So let maybe Rad jump in first, because you've had a big part in designing the two programs. Loaded stretching and the mobility masterclass, can and should they be done simultaneously?
I would 100% master the loaded stretching routine first, because that's the way that we designed the programs, and the way that we designed the programs is the way that we learnt, and the way that we learnt was that we always got to a point where we started to plateau and then look for the next thing, so we designed the next program. So the 18-minute stretching routine came first. We got a great result from it, then we plateaued, and then we looked deeper into what's the next kind of thing that we can do that we haven't been doing yet. And that was heavily influenced by Phil, because Phil at the time, like our programs had a lot of influence by Phil along the time, because you'd go away for 6 months, then you'd come back and you'd see changes and you'd comment on them and give us constructive criticism. And at the time you said, I'll never forget it, you said, man, I find it hard to be able to write a better program for the average person than what you've got. My only feedback would be is that you're still doing static stretching in the warm-up. And that, and then you reminded me, which is stuff that I knew, but we just weren't implementing it.
Set of external eyes to look in from a different viewpoint.
He reminded me why that wasn't the best way to do it. And that's what caused us to create the loaded stretching routine. So there was no static stretching in it. It was all about getting the muscles under load and, you know, going through eccentric contractions and things like that. And we went through a massive level up with our flexibility by doing that. And it prepared us, because the mobility masterclass was created after that. And we'd gone through an adaptation from the loaded stretching routine, and then we were looking for the next thing. So to go straight into the mobility masterclass, I'm not saying you can't do it, but it's just not what we did.
Yeah.
And you would have to be careful, because the load in the mobility masterclass is far higher than the load in the loaded stretching, because in the loaded stretching routine, there's no external load. It only uses your body weight for it, which is a much safer way to introduce loaded stretching. And the movements are amazing. Yeah. Though, Steve, what you're referring to, if anybody doesn't know what he's saying, should I master the three components of it? There's a lower body component, an upper body component, and a spine component. That routine has the most in-depth explanation of all the spine mobility out of anything that we've got out there, and it is phenomenal.
There's just a point on that there that you brought up that I really wanted to talk about with what we were talking about just before, which is that idea of plateauing, and that with targeted overreaching, that's a really great way for an experienced person who's had a lot of an older training age to get past those plateaus, because as I'm sure anyone who's trained in the gym for a while is experienced, you kind of, when you first start out, you're like, yeah, I'm killing it, and then suddenly it's like, oh, I can't keep going up by 5 kilos a week or whatever in your lift. and a lot of that can be explained by that neurological adaptation that you get from training, and that's initial strength increase that you get from training, and so it's really, I think, an important thing to understand for people who are just starting out in the progressions program. And you guys talk about this before, where like if it's your first peak week, take it easy, like just learn the moves, learn what it feels like to do this, because you're still going to get increases, because you're still getting those those neurological adaptations, you're still getting just strength increases from getting better at the technique. So like when we're talking about targeting overreaches, I just really wanted to make sure it's clear for people who are just starting out, like this is something that you've got to learn to do effectively and safely, and it just take it easy for the first few, as you guys have talked about before, and then that it becomes a really powerful tool to break through those plateaus when you start to get those diminishing returns, because you've sort of figured out how your neural stimulation
I actually spoke about that at the start of this week by saying to people that peak week doesn't mean you kill yourself. Peak week can mean as little as that you do one extra rep on every set, and that is enough to add volume over the whole, like one extra rep on every set over a whole week, there's a lot of volume that gets added in that 1 week. It's a great point to make.
Now quickly, should we go to Aiden's? I want to do Chris Grant first, because this is a real good one, and love, it's great question, for guys. Phil. But first I want to just give a couple of shout outs. We've got a couple of new people on the stream and on the show this morning. Hello, Nimala from Trinidad, which is really cool to see you here. Everyone that's tuned in here, thank you very much. Ruth Houseman, hi from the Blue Mountains. She's saying thank you for all the amazing programs. We got Clay on the show, not Brenda, watching from Indiana. I like Chris Grant's, because I think there's a lot of people here that can get something out of this question. He's saying during lockdown, he's been doing running after the UMS daily workouts most days, and now getting some shin splints deep in the soleus or medial side to where it hurts to walk if I go for a 5+ mile with pace. best releases or stretches to proactively keep this from happening. Now, my opinion on this is exactly what we're talking about. You know,
there's no stretching that you're going to do that's going to fix that.
Yeah, look, my opinion is that you're doing a lot of work in those initial workouts. You know, these UMS at home workouts are enough to fatigue even the best of us. Rad has a serious workout from that. You know, and so what you're doing is you're fatiguing a lot of areas of the body that need to be really supple and switched on when you go for a 5 mile run, and especially like the Golgi tendon. There's a lot of plyometric work in these workouts. There's a lot of springing. You need the elasticity in the body and the joints, and to immediately follow that up with a big run is, and like that is really intense load on the body. Yeah. You know?
And the thing that stands out to me is that it sounds like you've started doing this since the lockdown. Like this wasn't something you've done before. You haven't been, and you're saying you're running most days after the workout. So like this is classic story of, you know, usually going to work and you might go to the gym and, you know, maybe you do a couple of runs, like one or two runs a week, maybe. A lot of people in the, you know, who are now starting to run haven't done that before because it's just they're being forced to because they don't have access to gym. So it's this big change in loading where suddenly, you know, your body's like not used to this, and then you're suddenly stressing it in this very different way. That's going to overload things. I've talked about this a lot before, but you know, a lot of people want to just stretch or release their way out of things, but the muscles are spasming, or you're getting this pain because of like an inadequacy in strength and resilience to this type of exactly plyometric load. Like when you start using your tendons as springs, rather like it's a totally different stimulus that you're just not prepared for. And with shin splints as well, like as when I was talking about with the different adaptation times for structures before, bones are absolutely need stimulus to respond, and it's impact force that is the real thing that gives you increase in bone mineral density. But with an impact, some people get a bit freaked out by impact and think it's a bad thing, but it's so essential for bone growth. But like everything else, it needs to be graded exposure. If you suddenly go from like very little impact, maybe you do a few box jumps in the gym, to suddenly running, you know, 5+ miles a day, which in, you know,
which is a lot. Like, that's a good run. I mean, to give you an idea, guys, I've started running again for the first time since my knee reconstruction, which happened in 2013, I believe. So a long time ago, the year that we opened the gym, it happened. 7 years, I haven't been running. I used to run a lot when I was competitively boxing, but I was 10, 11, 12 kilos lighter than I am now. So first time I've ever run at over 90, I'm currently sitting about 92 and a half kilos. It's been a real, real adaptation for my body. So I've started by going for only a 2.6 kilometer run. That's like, 1.2 miles or something. Very short run, you know, in comparison to what my brain says I could do. And I've started experiencing quite severe pain in parts of my body, you know, so meaning that I'm overloading that those parts of my body to the extent where Phil's going to take a look at it today after the stream. It's very important that we understand that what the thing that Phil said there, that is the aha moment, which he said very quickly, is that it has to be progressively loaded. You can't just start something and dive up. You know, we call it the issue intensity continuum, where we're sort of, you know, gauging everything from a 0 to a 10 and going, in my opinion, to a 5 mile run. And Chris, hats off
at pace.
Hats off to you for the amount of effort that you're putting in. This is incredible, and this is exactly what we're talking about. We want to see people come out of this leveled up, better than they were when they went in. But it's critical that we get load management right.
Yeah. And in your let's be specific here. Then what I'd do, Chris, if I was you, I wouldn't be looking at what releases or stretches can you do. You need to reduce the load. If it was me, I'd immediately reduce how many times you go running down to once a week, and I wouldn't even run for the first couple of weeks. If you say that you're getting pain when you walk, walk for the next couple of weeks, just once or twice a week for a long walk, and if that doesn't hurt, then go to a gentle run and increase it like that.
Yeah, I mean, Rad's a bit of a running hater here. I understand people who like to to run, and that's not going to be quite satisfying enough. But what I'd say is that, you know, like at least have, to start off with, probably, you know, 48 hours in between your runs. So really, you know, probably no more than 3 in a week to start off with, and just start less than you think. Start back at like 1 mile. And like you're saying, it's really at pace where it starts to hurt. yeah, then if you're going, if it's that pushing it really fast, then, you know, maybe just bring it back a little bit, bring back the distance a whole lot, and yeah, don't keep pushing through pain with this sort of shin stuff. It can really just blow out and become like quite a big issue.
I got shin splints to the point where it really ended my boxing for about a year because I pushed through it. I pushed so hard. We did a period of training where we were training on concrete basketball courts, and when I was quite competitive, and we used to do just a million shuttle runs a week on this basketball court in our boxing attire. So I had like the knee high sort of boot, the mid shin boots with, you know, zero cushioning or protection or anything, sprinting up and down. And I was the type of person that went all in on my training. I was arguably the strongest or fittest in the group that we used to box with. And I wanted to win everything. I wanted to be the best. I was very competitive, you know, so I gave 1,000% in every training session, and there was no, My coach, God bless him, was very old fashioned. Think of like Rocky's coach in Rocky. You know, he pretty much talked like that too. I think Rad's met him once or twice, and there was no concept of overload and taper.
Come a long way.
You know, it was just like go do 100%. That was just and I blew my shins out so badly that you couldn't even touch them. I couldn't massage them. I couldn't do anything, and it was really, really. It took me a long time to get over. You know. So I think that there needs to be
saying he's gone from doing 2 to 3 runs a week at 3 miles or so prior to lockdown to doing a significant amount more. So I think probably try and bring it back to that baseline, how you like what you were doing before, see how that feels, and then just try and think about like, you know, you're currently trying to do this and you're starting from here. How do you connect the dots? Do you, you know, run at that wall or do you take the stairs? Like you've just got to gradually ramp it up. I wouldn't be doing it every single day, and especially like immediately after the
That's the thing that I was going to add. Just be really cautious about, because it's a different type of load that you're giving your body now that you're doing it immediately after the UMS workout when everything's already fatigued and depleted. So maybe that could be the key element here. Like what I do is I do my workout in strength in the morning and then I go for a run in the evening. So my body's had 8 hours between that run to sort of recover, and I'm literally just sitting in my desk and stretching and doing some stuff like that. To answer your question, you know, massage balls, foam rolling, all that sort of stuff is really effective for the lower extremities like that, around the calves, myofascial release, things like that will help, but nothing is going to solve the problem but better load management. It's just the lack of good load management there.
Yeah. Let's answer Aiden's question. He got in first here. He's saying, hey guys, heading into deload week for phase 2 foundations, well done. Always been curious of the split squat variations. Am I to assume that these are done using no weight? Are they meant to be more of a calf and hip flexor stretch? The weight is always about load management. It's not about it should be done with weight or it shouldn't be. It's about if doing a body weight split squat is too easy for you and you do it with good technique, then you add load to make it harder. So that's all it is.
I've seen many people in our gym who come who are new, who haven't done these types of movements before, have to deload and actually support their body weight to take body weight off.
With a dowel rod.
But to give you an example, man, I've worked up to doing 80 kilo split squats.
Yep.
With a barbell on my back, you know, so.
But in the foundations program, if you want weight, you just hold dumbbells in your hands. And are they meant to be more of a calf and hip flexor stretch? Yes and no. They're meant to be, what they do is it's a unilateral way of developing a squat. The reason why it's called a split squat and not a lunge is because what goes on in the ankle, knee, and hip in the front leg is exactly the same as what goes on in a squat. There's the same level of flexion and extension that happens. Of course, the mechanism is a little bit different, but it creates unilateral strength in the squat. But what it also does is it really allows you to push the flexibility by driving the knee forward and also by trying to keep the back knee off the ground, which does work on hip flexors and calf flexibility. So it's a really, it's like a, you know, strengthening and stretching exercise, and it's a really, really good exercise.
It's one of
which is why we put it in there.
Yeah.
It's one of the best bang for your buck exercises out there by a long shot.
Yep.
So let's move on to. We've said Carmichael. So we've said hi to Ruth. Nirmala Suku is saying hi from Trinidad.
Yeah, I've already read that. Let's just jump down to Maj, which is Nick May.
Yep. He's saying, I've got A clicking knocking through my center line at the back when I do bicycle crunches. No pain, but weird and not so comfortable. And then he's got a little addition to it down here. He says, well, Phil, have you got anything you want to say about that before we go to the second part of it?
Where's the addition?
Well, that's all, because the addition is something separate.
Yep. Okay.
Clicking, knocking through the center line when he does bicycle crunches.
I think often people get a bit freaked out by clicking, and so often it's just not a big deal.
Did you hear the click that just happened? Yeah,
exactly.
I get clicks all the time.
When
you
hear Yanni squat, it's like, you know,
it's like an orchestra. It's a symphony of different things clicking and popping.
Yeah, and obviously when it starts to get into your back, and if it's like consistent like that, I can totally understand that it makes you feel pretty uncomfortable. It's just one thing I'd... if there's any sort of other symptoms going around, like any tingling, numbness, any of that sort of stuff, if you're getting pain down your legs, anything down your arms, like anything where it starts to feel like there's a connection between the clicking and any other symptom, or if it clicks a lot and it starts to develop pain gradually over time, then certainly I think that's, I think it's worth kind of just having anything with your spine generally kind of looked over. But if it's just like a little clicking that doesn't cause any pain, isn't connected to any other symptoms, doesn't start to build over time, then I wouldn't be too concerned about it. But
cool.
Yeah.
So Nick's addition to the question is, he's saying, also all my other muscles feel springy and elastic, but my middle splits feels like a piece of stiff rope. Rad, what was the progression with your middle splits flexibility? I almost feel like as I'm getting more conditioned, they're getting tighter. Do you get that springy feeling in your middle splits? When I get to the end range of my middle splits, it feels like a stiff, tight rope. And I got to a point where I wasn't getting better for 6 months, and it really, really frustrated me. And the only way I got better was when I did less.
Yeah.
And allowed my body the time to recover, didn't force it, and just allowed the adaptation to happen. Yeah. The worst thing that I found for my middle splits was trying to force it, and there's nothing you can do to force the adaptation that's going to happen in your nervous system. Your nervous system will learn that it's okay and will relax the muscles and the tissue to allow you to go deeper only through more exposure to it, and the exposure has to be done in a way where it only goes to the point of discomfort, not to the point of pain. And the best results that I'm getting now is by doing middle splits only once a week and then doing daily mobility just like what we do at the end of the class.
I've got something really important to add for the middle splits, guys. Middle splits is something that most people, unless you have been stretching from childhood and your body's completely adapted to really going deep in your stretches, what you got to understand is the middle splits is the only really intense flexibility drill that has a high level of risk, a high degree of risk to not only the hips where you're getting the stretch, but the knees. It puts the knees in a very, very vulnerable position. Now, any vulnerability that the brain senses, it's going to make you really restrict that movement. It's going to prevent the movement because it knows that there's a high risk of injury if it allows you to achieve that position. So the middle splits is one of those movements that you have to be patient with, and it will help that you're strengthening your body at the same time, strengthening movements like the squat. You want to strengthen the knees, you know, because you're really, really putting, when you're in that position, you're really putting a lot of lateral force on and load on the knee.
Yeah, exactly. As talked about before, with your ligaments adapting, you've got your MCL on the inside of your knee there. Like as you start to expose it to load like that, it will have that signal to be like, oh, okay, here's a, you know, direction that we need to strengthen in. Whereas if you just go from, you know, zero to hero with it and really push it, then you haven't given that ligament time to adapt. So
yeah. Yep.
And remember when we talk about tissue adaptation times, it's more, you know, 3 months and onwards. So
yeah, you just have to allow it to take time. The people at our gym that learned how to do the middle splits from before they were here, it's taken them years to do. It's not something that you can do it in probably 12 months. And in 6 months, you can see a massive change if you do it the right way. But what most people get wrong, Nick, is most people go too hard. They do too much rather than not enough. Yeah. And we've been told for so long that if you want to get flexible, you've got to stretch every day. Well, that's true. But it's not that you do the middle splits every day and you try to get better at the middle splits every day.
It's a big misconception. The middle splits is the one movement that I've been the most astonished by as to how much our tribe have leveled up. When I walk in the morning and Rad's leading a class for either the 6 a.m. or 7 a.m. crew, there's usually like 12 or 15 people who are doing mega impressive middle splits. But what you guys got to understand, and I don't know where you fall into this picture, Nick, our guys are doing as much strength work as they're doing flexibility work. They're doing the full UMS program, you know, where they've gone through and built a really strong foundation. You know, they've done all those split squats. They've done all that really good end range strength and loaded stretching. They've moved through all of those steps. And so by the time they really start to double down on that mobility masterclass and they're doing those middle splits workouts, they're really well prepared for it and conditioned to it. And I'm talking about people like Niall, Lockie, Matt Stevens, Lee, you know, like there's a lot of, and I'm talking all guys because we've got a lot of girls who are really flexible, but I've actually got a girl here that I'm going to show, always impressed by the dudes because they all come in as like ex-CrossFitters and stuff like that, who are real stiff and strong, you know, and then in a year or so's time, they're doing these incredible middle splits. So really what I want to just say, that the key insight from that is that it's not just the stretching that's going to get you there with those really complex stretching positions. You've got to be strengthening as well. Yeah. And that's where our UMS philosophy of a one-to-one balance between strength and flexibility really comes into play. I don't see people achieving that movement who are just focusing on stretching.
Yeah, and with you know, that kind of explanation that he had about you know, the rest of the muscles feel pretty like springy, whereas that feels like it's not springy. And when we've talked about when your muscles are overloaded, it's that spasm and that, you know, it just wants to hold on to protect itself. So a muscle that's in spasm and is trying to protect itself is not going to be a springy muscle. Yeah. So yeah, taking the volume back to, you know, once a week and really building up the structures around it, giving you the tendons where it attaches into the bone and the ligaments that are connecting the bones time to just adapt and the muscle time to adapt and get used to lengthening under tension, that's what's going to give it that springy, confident feeling. So,
yeah, awesome. Just saw that we got Biwa Kwan, one of our awesome moderators on the live stream. Hi, Biwa. It's great to see you here.
You want to get another question
awesome
going?
We've got time for one. Yeah, that's right. You wait, Bia, until you see the setup next week when we get it all put together again. It's going to be so awesome. Next time you come into the gym, we'll have to give you a tour in the studio here. Who have we got? Let's find one more. We've got time for one more quick question before we break out and get our workouts done.
I've got Steve. What about Steve's with the intermittent fasting?
Yeah, that one. And I would also like to cover, someone asked, I saw before, when's the best time to take the collagen protein? And, you know, it's really, there's evidence and research to indicate that right before a workout is good, but it can make you feel really sick right before a workout. So most of the research that I've seen is just saying within a half hour window, immediately after workout, is usually optimal to get a protein supplement in, because dietary protein is sort of like the on switch for muscle protein synthesis, which is one of the pathways that we want switched on to rebuild and repair the tissues. There's another, you know, Dr. Gary Slater is someone who I follow in this space. He's really, really good. Probably Dr. Gary Slater or Dr. Lane Norton are the two that I'm really into following for muscle protein synthesis, because they both did their PhDs on this topic specifically. And, you know, Gary once said that he hadn't proved it, but he was doing a lot of research at the Queensland or Gold Coast University here in Australia on this, as to whether taking branched chain amino acids and protein supplements during a workout would actually interfere with the process that you want. Because essentially when you're training for muscular hypertrophy, which is the size of the muscle, you want to be causing as much metabolic damage to the tissue as possible. And if you're taking a supplement in that's actually triggering the repair process to switch on during the period where you're trying to damage the tissue, he had a theory that it may actually impair the process. You know, it's kind of sending mixed signals to the body. And he said, look, it's a watch this space area of research. I'd have to dig into the research to figure out whether that's true, but it was enough to convince me that, you know, there's good evidence to prove that straight after the workout is the best time to take your protein supplement.
Yeah, that's a classic sort of anabolic window. You know,
that's right.
Get it in then.
One of the things that he did suggest, though, is that, you know, that anabolic window reopens every sort of 2 to 3 hours. And depending on the level of intensity of your training, you keep getting the opportunity to re-switch on muscle protein synthesis for up to 72 hours for a really intense workout. And so, you know, taking dietary protein in just after your training is not the only time you need to do it. If you're training to the intensity that we train at 5 days a week, really every 2 to 3 hours, you have a new opportunity to switch on that mechanism and maximize your muscle protein synthesis. For the specificity of this question in regards to the intermittent fast. So I'll give my opinion first. I'll read it out. Real question. After big effort today in peak week, am feeling very hungry, but am in intermittent fast till midday. Is it better to wait, or would it be better to have some protein? This is very much down to what your goals are,
That's
Steve.
What I was gonna say.
Intermittent fasting is not the be all and end all. It doesn't solve the world's hunger problems. It doesn't do the, you know, if your primary goal is to build muscle tissue, then I would certainly say have a protein shake. If your primary goal is overall health, then I would say abstain from food and get your fast completed. It really comes down to what your primary goal is. And for us, for Rad and I, you know, longevity and overall health is very important.
Well, I can give a specific answer for myself, because Yani was saying there is, we do fast every day, 7 days a week. But recently in this lockdown phase, I really had a look at how can I achieve something that I've never achieved before. And I've upper body weakness has been the downfall of me for learning calisthenics. I just haven't had the strength in my upper body that I've needed. So I've been training in a way where my number one goal was to build as much strength and as much mass in my upper body as possible. So I've actually been not fasting on the days that I do my upper body training and the day straight after it. And I have a protein shake straight after that first workout in the morning. Whereas every other day I fast, even though I do that workout straight away, there's another 4 hours before I have my first meal. So that's an example of how you can use a shake or a fast, depending on what your goals are.
Yeah, I think it's an interesting one with like the kind of longevity piece of intermittent fasting and looking at just with, as you age and the changes in your muscle mass, like changes in muscle mass has a massive impact on longevity and you know, with Steve, like, you know, at like in your 60s, it might be kind of that calculus is maybe a bit more important to hold on to your muscle mass to keep you strong and fit and metabolically well and you know, protected from the things that I just saw so much when I was doing physio in emergency departments, or you just see, you know, people getting that sort of frailty piece. So I think that it's just a
very
when you think
point.
About your goals and your the calculus sort of changes as you age as well. So
Look, my people often ask when they come to the gym, even if their primary goal is sort of weight loss, although we're definitely not a weight loss gym, and we tend to steer people away if that's their primary goal because there are better solutions out there. But we get a lot of people who are sort of like, why do you guys prioritize so much strength training? Why is it always such a priority to meet your dietary protein needs and things like that? Everybody should be prioritizing maintaining muscle tissue, because there is no hiding the fact that once you hit a certain age, it is very hard to maintain or even gain muscle tissue. And it gets harder and harder and harder. Even with the best workout, with the right stimulus, it just gets very, very difficult. And
probably more importantly, that if you're not working to maintain it, you are losing it.
That's exactly right.
That is, you know, guaranteed. It's happening. And that's what causes osteoporosis and osteoarthritis and
frailty and early death, you know. Yeah, this is something that Phil's been had a very good insight into, as he has done placements in hospitals and things like that. Yeah,
same people who just couldn't stand up out of a chair, not because they had anything wrong with them, just because older lady in particular who just, you know, she just didn't do anything and didn't stand up, and so no conditions wrong with her, just her legs were this thin and she just couldn't stand up. And obviously that's like the real extreme thing. But when you look at emergency departments and when I was working in subacute geriatric rehab hospitals, it was just 80% of the people there were there just because they fell over, because they didn't have the strength and they didn't have that resiliency. They didn't have the stimulus for their bones, the impact, all those things that we're talking about today about how to build up your system. If you take that out, then, you know, your system won't be able to handle
big
simple
problems.
Things. So.
Great show today, guys. Great questions. Great, like really. Absolutely. Remember, guys, if you do have questions for these shows, get them in nice and early. You don't have to ask them here. You can send them through via email to either Phil or myself, and we will answer them live every Friday. We do Physio Friday, and Phil is also going live every Monday,
Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, 3 p.m.
And so you can get your questions directly to Phil. You can ask them on this group, or guys, of course, if you're in the UMS online coaching group, we'll always answer those questions
and just
first.
Kind of disclaimer again, I'm really looking to try and build like general principles. It's not like a one-on-one consultation. It's not specific medical advice. It's just trying to give you those sort of things to think about when you're think about your injuries and whether or not you should see someone and all those sort of things. So
absolutely. All right, it's Friday here in Australia. Big shout out to everyone listening on the Sound of Movement podcast. We're very grateful for everyone who's listening there. It's something that we're really going all in on to grow. And shout out to everyone watching the replay of this on the YouTube channel. Biggest shout out, though, goes to all of those who joined us live and asked us questions and interacted to make the show so brilliant. Yeah. Thank you, Phil, for joining us.
Good to talk to humans.
Thank you, Rad. for just being rad, and thank you, Richie, for producing such a lovely show with no issues technically. See you all next week, guys.
Before the live stream.
Health is about performance, not just body image.
You better be willing to accept what you're going to have to do to get there.
We'll start focusing on movement goals, strength goals, flexibility goals.
When you nail that skill, it's there forever.
The body image goal doesn't get you that far.
It's the consistency and frequency that's going to get you there. It's not the intensity.
There's no shortcut to mastery in movement. Destination doesn't change overnight, but your direction will.
The gym is not the place to beat up the body that you hate. It's the place to build the body that you love.
We are the gym that teaches people how to move instead of just exercise, because we believe that health is about performance, not just body image.